It's fight time, ladies and gentlemen. It's Thursday, February 9, 2012. I'm Aaron Dykes, sitting in for Alex tonight. All indications are for a war with Iran. Meanwhile, we are definitely being occupied here on the, quote, homeland. FEMA camps are getting ready. Homeland Stasi shows no signs of letting up. There's a lot of important news. At the same time, it's a continuation of what our loyal viewers have known for a long time is coming. Now, we have coming up on the broadcast Dr. Paul Craig Roberts, the former Reagan administration official, economic expert, and a whole lot more. And we're going to cover his article, bluntly titled, Will Iran Be Attacked? Of course, there are all kinds of indicators that there are large preparations for that war, open statements from Israel and the U.S., and a whole lot more. But Dr. Roberts makes a lot of interesting points in his article. Not only are there 44 U.S. military bases surrounding Iran and all kinds of statements where Obama's tiptoeing the line of appearing not to encourage or endorse an Israeli strike on Iran while at the same time trying to appease Democratic peace groups ahead of re-election and appearing to give sanctions time to develop before an attack is on. But there's also the Western finance Russian opposition, which Dr. Roberts points out, may kind of bind the hands of Russia in regards to further escalation of Middle East wars, as Putin may have to sort of face his own accusations of being a dictator and an election stealer in March, when a lot of people believe the Iran war could be a go. Now, meanwhile, Dr. Roberts points out in this article, and of course we're going to cover it in detail coming up later in this program, that there's really been a propaganda war against Iran, not just since the Bush administration, but since 1979 when the Shah was thrown out of power, and that's really just been going on. And since so much of this is based on all the false accusations surrounding the nuclear power plants and their real intentions, I just want to show this piece of propaganda from the 70s when the Shah was still in power, when he was a happy Western puppet and Iran was a good country for a time being, according to the Western globalist press. Guess who's building nuclear power plants? The Shah of Iran is sitting on top of one of the largest reserves of oil in the world. Yet he's building two nuclear plants and planning two more to provide electricity for his country. He knows the oil's running out, more propaganda, and time with it, but he wouldn't build the plants now if he doubted their safety, more propaganda. He'd wait, as many Americans want to do, but the Shah knows that nuclear energy is not only economical, it's enjoyed a remarkable 30-year safety record. If it's good enough for him, it's good enough for Plymouth, Massachusetts, too. And it just goes to show they can spin the facts any way they want, any time they want, depending on what the globalists want to do. We know Iran's been on the hit list, and we really hope the time isn't now, but it's kind of that feeling before World War I when all the countries line up. Now, meanwhile, we have in the news today, U.S. warplanes head to the Gulf at rate not seen in years. That's according to Debka File, another kind of shadowy, nebulous intelligence source. So take it with a grain of salt. But what are we dealing with here? Regional conflicts where the bankers back all sides of the war. As the U.S. and Israel carried on bickering over the right time to strike Iran's nuclear sites, Debka File writes, the war preparations continue to pace. Debka File's military sources report that flight after flight of U.S. warplanes and transports were seen this week cutting eastward through the skies of Sinai on their way to the Gulf destinations, presumably Saudi Arabia, at a frequency not seen in the Middle East for many years. Of course, we know there are many big cruise ships there, big launching pads, ally bases. All the regional players have been tapped, and we really hope this doesn't become World War III or a wider regional conflict, but they have on their hit list Iran and Syria, as I've mentioned many times tonight and other times on this program, and they look like they're going to go forward. We hope they don't do it. Now, some have interpreted Obama's comment that I don't think Israel has made a decision on what they need to do as simply meaning he wants to wait until the sanctions have the appearance of having had their effect before having the strike. We don't know, of course, what's going to happen. No one knows the hour, but we know they're working steadily at it. Meanwhile, Mossad works with terror groups to assassinate Iranian nuclear scientists. That's Kurt Nemo's article up on InfoWars today. Of course, he points out it's obvious that the Western intelligence agencies would have full knowledge if this is proven to be going on as well. There's sources from Iran's press TV citing the same. But these articles have been ongoing for 6 months. They've had attempts on Khomeini. They've had attempts on Ahmadinejad. They've been taking out these scientists, all these other explosions. And it's intelligence ops. There's evidence. It's connected to the Israelis. And you can see it there in the quotes. And they are arming and training and backing the MEK, the Mojahideen-e-Khalik organization, a known terrorist group listed with the State Department as a terrorist group. And yet we have open ties with them. Well, what do you expect? We're openly working with Al-Qaeda, first in Libya. Now those groups have been openly exported to Syria. They'll work with whatever they want and sell whatever lies are convenient to the public. It's just a sad day. Now, turning to the homeland front, sources expose FEMA training camp in Missouri. Alex had on this person today on the air, an anonymous source who's been contracted to work inside a facility at Fort Leonard Woods, Missouri, where he explains how there's been a lot of activity building towards the FEMA training camps. Now, we've reported in the weeks past how they are activating these camps, how KBR has put out bids seeking contractors, people to stand by on 72 hours notice, ready to man the camps at all levels, provide cleanup services, food, catering, but also the fencing services that they can roll out at rapid speed, get it ready to house people in whatever kind of crisis or emergency might be coming. Of course, with the economic crisis always on watch. He said also that he's describing it as a civilian inmate training camp, and told InfoWars he spotted foreign troops as well in maroon and purple uniforms instructing troops on baton tactics and crowd control techniques. So again, this is obviously some form of training of dealing with the American people once the economic crisis or a new war or whatever hits that tipping point, that threshold, that turning point. He said there's been, quote, incredible activity at the camp since the passage of NDAA. And we've seen it in the propaganda and the other reports. It's sad. But that's what direction things are going. A little bit of positive news, at least on the surface. Janet Dung Beetle, as Alex now calls her, Napolitano, will have to testify before the House Subcommittee on Ignorance and Counterterrorizing in the House. EPIC, the Electronic Privacy Information Center group, has gotten these hearings held on after recently attaining close to 300 pages of documents as the result of a Freedom of Information Act lawsuit detailing the federal agency's intelligence gathering practices on the web. Among the documents were guidelines for the DHS instructing outside contractors, there's those contractors again, to monitor the web for media reports and comments that, quote, reflect adversely on the agency or the federal government. So here you have the Homeland Stasi network no longer fighting terrorism, admittedly, if they even ever were, if there even are terrorists, always just spying on the American people, legitimizing the destruction of the Bill of Rights under various pretexts. They'll sell whatever they think they can to the Republic, to the public in what was once the Republic. Meanwhile, they're not only looking for, quote, threats and hazards and evidence of the next big threat, emerging threats, but also any media reports that reflect adversely on the U.S. government or DHS. Now, of course, we reported back in 2010 how DHS was spying on the drudgereport.com, how they were spying on Infowars.com. That came out in Reuters last month, how in early 2010, contractors were 24/7 monitoring Facebook, Twitter, Hulu, WikiLeaks, sites like Huffington Post, and that Drudge Report thing again for any sign of trolling the trolls, of calling out a occupying force for what it is, of saying, hey, that's unconstitutional, what that group is doing. I mean, how dare us? Now, it's great that EPIC got these hearings held. They've come out on free speech and civil rights grounds, of course. Most of their work has been very good. But we have a problem because they're just going to keep going. They show no signs of letting up. People inside this subcommittee have already commented that they want Homeland Security to be monitoring the internet, monitoring blogs, social media for signs of, quote, the current or emerging threats. That would be Reps Jackie Speier and Reps Patrick Meehan, among others, if you think it's good to still contact your members and tell them not to do it. Meanwhile, let's just watch for this hearing. It's going to be Thursday, February 16th, DHS monitoring of social networking and media, enhancing intelligence gathering and ensuring privacy. Admittedly, they have fusion centers set up all across the country, merging with local and state law enforcement to spy on the people, political groups, on and on. You know the deal. But it's always fun to see the dung beetle on TV. And of course, there were reports in 2004 that Homeland Security actually hired the former Stasi spy chief Marcus Wolf from East Germany to work for Homeland Security. There's kind of some speculation over whether or not that's true, but hey, that's how they're acting. It may as well be true if it's not literally true. They've obviously adopted that model. They're trying to turn the American people against each other to create a nationwide snitch network. They have a little InfraGuard and the other entities. And they really want to just create all-out paranoia. You've seen the reports this week from the FBI where they have page after page of mundane, ordinary American activity, using cash, going to internet cafes, using model airplanes, all kinds of stuff, tattoo shops, going to cosmetic shops, beauty shops. Everything the American people do is considered suspicious and the act of potential terrorism. You've seen all the reports. Just let's face what this is. It's an occupying force. It's disgusting what they have going on, and we should all be worried about it. Meanwhile, Paul Joseph Watson has written about how Homeland Security is now launching, quote, insurgent tracking drones inside America. And they're going to ramp this up on a big $50 million budget, have these drones all over. They've already tapped law enforcement agencies, encouraged their use. You've seen the cases where the news media reported in Houston and other places that they were already testing and using these things. And you, of course, heard about the case in North Dakota where they used the drone to spy on the family with all the acreage that supposedly stole six cows. And I don't know if you did see the report also from this week where the European Union is now using drones to spy on and do farmland inspections because it's such vast farmland. They have to use these drones to find fines and things that are against the EU's code of bureaucratic dictatorship for farmland. Turning to other matters, the economic collapse always does these great list articles. This one is good, especially if you're a newbie to the broadcast or if you're spreading this broadcast to new listeners, people who haven't heard this before. It is the 10 things every American should know about the Federal Reserve, then kind of that Woody Allen asterisk, but we're afraid to ask or never knew or we're busy watching the football game and never asked. So here's that list now. I'll read all 10. The Federal Reserve System is a privately owned banking cartel. The truth is the privately owned central bank is owned by the banks that are members of the Federal Reserve System. We do not know how much of the system each bank owns because that has never been disclosed to the American people. No right to know. Number two, the Federal Reserve System is a perpetual debt machine. You probably heard about that too, how every dollar issued comes back to the Federal Reserve in the form of interest. But there's some interesting quotes in here I've never heard, maybe you've never heard them, from Thomas Edison, of all people, back in the early part of the 20th century. He was in the New York Times at the time saying, that is to say, under the old way, anytime we wish we could add to the national wealth, we are compelled to add to the national debt. Now, that's what Henry Ford wants to prevent. He thinks it's stupid, and so do I, that for the loan of $30 million of our own money, the people of the United States should be compelled to pay $66 million, that is what it amounts to, with interest. That's double the amount of the loan and a little bit extra in interest. And he says it's bad, but somehow it's become accepted. We got used to it, didn't we? Number three, the Federal Reserve has destroyed more than 96% of the value of the dollar. I know we have a graph, I don't recall who made it, it's been out there for years, with the design of the dollar bill showing that destruction of the purchasing power of your dollar. You've heard Ron Paul talking about it, and it's true. You took what used to be the dollar when it was on a true gold standard, gold and silver standard in the early part of the 20th century, and how since 1913, it's had some ups and downs, but overall, it's been a 96% decline of total value. Number four, the Federal Reserve can bail out whoever it wants with no accountability. And the partial audit they finally got in Congress revealed that it's all the big banks of Wall Street and pretty much all the big banks of Europe. Go figure. Number five, the Federal Reserve is paying banks not to lend money. Now, what does that mean? Section 128 of the Emergency Economic Stabilization Act of 2008 allows the Federal Reserve to pay interest on excess reserves that the bank parks at the Fed. So what happened? You had no excess reserves up until that act was passed in 2008. Now you have $1.5 trillion in there. The banks are putting the money in there, gaining interest payments, collecting their own money and not loaning it out to people, not loaning it to small businesses, not allowing any kind of economic recovery. There isn't one. Paul Craig Roberts is going to talk about that later, what a hoax that is. Number six, the Federal Reserve creates artificial economic bubbles that are extremely damaging. Do you remember that their whole mandate for being created was that they were going to stop the fluctuations, the spikes, the bust and booms, the market crashes? They didn't do any of that. The greatest crash ever, the economic depression of the late 20s, of the 30s, was created by the Federal Reserve. It wasn't stopped by them. They contracted the money supply and some other fishy moves after they crashed Wall Street. Number seven, the Federal Reserve System is dominated by the big Wall Street banks. Now, that should be obvious at that point, especially after the partial audit. However, I believe Jamie Dimon is on the board of reserves. And also, of course, Treasury Secretary Timothy Geithner came from there. At the very best, we're talking about a very, very corrupt revolving door system. But we know it's far worse than just revolving door problems. Number eight, it is not an accident that we saw the personal income tax and the Federal Reserve System both come into existence in 1913. So they could collect that interest money that Thomas Edison, Henry Ford, and so many other Americans, whether they're good, bad, indifferent, colored, corrupt themselves, whatever. It was 1913. They began to turn the lights out on the American dream. Not that we were ever perfect, not that we ever achieved that dream, but they turned us instead towards that Soviet model, toward the rule by central authority model, rule by private entities controlling the government, not by a government responsible to the democratic people of the country through reserved limited powers under a republic. Number nine, the current Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke has a nightmarish track record of incompetence. Now, that can't be true. Number 10, the Federal Reserve has become way too powerful. Or was it always too powerful and completely unconstitutional? Crazy. But anyway, someone, a listener, sent us an interesting dollar here, some artwork. Ron Paul's face on a dollar bill, and it says, "And the Federal Reserve." I don't know if we could show that. Hopefully we can zoom in. Interesting artwork there. Just a little something extra for our viewers out there. I appreciate everyone supporting this broadcast and trying to spread the word. On the back, it says, "In gold we trust." Interesting there. Anyway, that's it for tonight's InfoWars Nightly News segment. We, of course, have Dr. Paul Craig Roberts coming up. But first, I want to read you a daily quote. After reminding you, we're extending our special discounts on the Prison Planet TV membership. A lot of people like to sign up that way because it costs less. You could save money. Of course, you could share that membership with up to five other people. So you can give it to friends, family, other people who are awake, other people who you want to try to awaken. It's a great tool of giving information, of giving truth, as we try to reach enough people to turn this thing around. You know it's so important, and if you want to help this broadcast, please check that out and consider subscribing. Now, Marcus Tullius Cicero, of course from the Roman days, wrote, "The traitor appears, not a traitor. He speaks in accents familiar to his victims, and he wears their face and their arguments. He appeals to the baseness that lies deep in the hearts of all men. He infects the body politic so that it can no longer resist. A murderer is less to fear. The traitor is the plague." And I believe the quote goes on to explain how at least they come out in the open. You can recognize that kind of enemy at the gates, but the enemy within the gates is a lot harder to deal with and a lot more evil. And that's the kind of enemy we face today. I hope you're beginning to inform yourself out there, and I hope you'll keep tuning in to our broadcasts. Stay tuned. Dr. Paul Craig Roberts after this break.
Greetings, fellow Info Warriors. Alex Jones here, announcing the first of many trips that I'm going to take across this wonderful United States that we live in. And we get so busy here at InfoWars.com, the nightly news, the daily radio show, the documentary films, and all the other things we're doing that I tend to never go out and give speeches anymore. And I've got a lot of ideas bubbling around in my head about the history of the New World Order, what makes them tick, and how to defeat them. So I'm titling this key speech I'm going to give. It'll run around 2 hours long, Blueprint to Defeat the New World Order. And we're also going to have a surprise premiere of a short documentary film we've been working on at the event. First off, I'm going to be going to Dallas, Texas, Sunday, February 19th, 2012, to the historic Lakewood Theater. And the next Sunday, February 26th, I'm going to be in Orlando, Florida. You can find out more about the events and buy tickets at Infowars.com/events. Now, unfortunately, every event I've ever had, we've had to turn people away. So get your tickets early at Infowars.com/events. There's a lot of crazy stuff going on in this world. And the craziest of all is this explosive awakening. I can't wait to meet you and shake your hand. I'll see you in Dallas and I'll see you in Orlando. Infowars.com/events. Sign of these evil 1776 flags. Doesn't get any more out of control than that, ladies and gentlemen. It's pretty un-American what we're doing here at Infowars.com. I mean, not only are we promoting liberty, but we're selling 1776 flags. Now that is Al-Qaeda.
And we are back from break. Joining us now to discuss the large buildup for war as well as a number of economic issues is Dr. Paul Craig Roberts. He was Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for Economic Policy under Reagan. He's worked for the Wall Street Journal and a number of other publications and organizations. He now has his own blog at paulcraigroberts.org. Doctor, thank you for joining us.
Pleased to be with you.
I'm pleased to have you as well, but not too pleased about the apparent buildup to war. It's been said, obviously, in a different context, no man knoweth the hour, but still we see quite the buildup. What do you see on the front, sir?
Yes, buildup's been going on a long time, and it seems excessive if no attack on Iran is intended. You know, Juan Cole published a map showing that there are 44 American military bases surrounding Iran. We've got two fleets assigned to the Persian Gulf along with NATO warships. We've got American troops posted to Kuwait and Israel. We've got a missile defense system up for Israel. We've got missiles in a variety of our Arab puppet states. So it looks like a war is intended, or attack is intended. You know, it used to be military strategists would say that once mobilization had reached a certain point, war was inevitable. I don't know if they still teach that or not, but that was once the view. And in terms of that view, it certainly looks like war is inevitable.
Yes, sir. Now, in the lead up to the Iraq war, we saw a large propaganda effort to sell us on the ideas of mobile weapons labs and WMDs, all of which turned out to be false. Here we've got basically the nuclear case, but they haven't even been hitting that as hard. Do you expect a further propaganda buildup prior to a movement, or should we be looking to things like false flag attacks and other coming conflicts short of all-out war?
You know, I don't know how it will start. In fact, it may start despite the White House's opposition to the timing. There's so many people in position to start the war with a false flag attack or anything else. You know, there have been several books published about how President John F. Kennedy came near to being sandbagged by the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the CIA into a Cuban invasion and into a nuclear preemptive first strike on the Soviet Union. He saw in time what they were boxing him into and rejected it. And it's entirely possible there could be a false flag attack, even one orchestrated by the Israelis that would force the hand of the United States. in my own opinion, I don't think Obama wants to take the risk of a war with Iran because of the possible disruption of oil, the escalation in price, and this would have serious effects on the United States and European economies. I don't think he wants to take that risk unless polls show that he's losing the election with whoever the Republican candidate turns out to be. So I think he would prefer to wait. Others probably see the spring, early spring, as a prime time to attack because Russia may be in turmoil over its elections. You know, the Russian elections are in March, and the NGOs, the non-governmental organizations funded with the American taxpayers' money from the National Endowment for Democracy, that's how much of the Russian opposition is financed. Mm. And so they're already having demonstrations accusing the upcoming elections of being fixed. So if yes, Putin wins, you could see more demonstrations, and they could easily turn violent. You could see Russia sort of paralyzed by the kinds of upheavals that we've seen in other parts of the world recently. And this would make them ineffective, perhaps, in responding or in attempting to block or forestall an attack on Iran. And I'm sure that those planning the war would be more comfortable if they had Russia preoccupied with its own internal problems. So there'll be some conflict, I think, between what some people will see as an ideal time and what Obama would see as an ideal time.
Right.
And the outcome's not predictable.
I think that's a wise observation to put Russia in context. I mean, obviously, there's geopolitical points on the map of interest, but you've also got the General Wesley Clark account. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but he cites a meeting with Paul Wolfowitz in, I believe, 1991. And Wolfowitz laid out a hit list of countries, Iran, Syria, they were all on the list. And his reason for the timing had to do with Russia and other superpowers not being in a position, at least of interest, to intervene in Middle Eastern interventions and conflicts.
Yes, I think they still think a lot about that. And of course, on February 14th, the Vice President of China is coming to Washington. And how that meeting goes would probably also feed into the decision. What we have to come back to is we've had all these years of propaganda, and the people making these propaganda claims against Iran know that they're not true. You may have seen some of the latest propaganda claims come from congressmen and senators in Washington who are talking about Iranian influence in South America, that the Iranians are now penetrating South America and organizing terror strikes against the United States. So there's really, I mean, that's absurd, of course, but there's no end to the propaganda, and the people making it have to know that it's false. And so they're making it for some reason. And as we've already said, the organization of so many military forces and being in place, that also implies intent. It's expensive to do that. there's even some speculation that the reason the United States is winding down the Iraq and Afghan wars is to free up the wherewithal to take on Iran. I don't know whether this speculation is right or not, but a lot of people see the movement toward preparing this massive force against Iran, and so something must lie behind it.
Yes, sir. How do you see the operations in Syria, all the propaganda trying to topple Assad's regime, all the covert warfare going on there, playing into the wider regional war or the Iran crisis?
Well, it's part of the original plan to overturn all the independent Middle Eastern countries. So you had Iraq, Syria, Iran, and they want to get rid of those countries that are not American puppet states. Mm-hmm. So Syria could very well end up like Libya. I think there's been a lot of information that's probably reliable that shows that the United States is financing the rebels in Syria, certainly encouraging them. And so if the propaganda can reach the right level and somehow we can get around China and Russia, I think you would see NATO intervention in Syria along the lines that occurred in Libya. But so far, China and Russia have blocked that. And whether Washington will try to push despite that opposition, I don't know.
And I guess two final questions on the Iranian front. One, do you think the global political awakening, will the people buy another war in terms of media hype? And two, is this a real strain we see in the U.S.-Israeli relationship, or do you think that'll be a factor whether or not the war actually happens?
Now, I don't think there can be any real strain in the relationship because the Israeli government owns Congress. Everyone knows that. The Congress knows it. The Israeli government knows it. And anyone who pays any attention knows it. So they own Congress. I think the Israelis, the government, not necessarily all the Israeli people, but the Israeli government, it's right-wing, somewhat crazed. And I think they get carried away with their influence and power over the United States government, and they lose their patience if they meet the slightest resistance, like they have apparently met recently from Obama, who has good reasons for not wanting the war right now. And so they, you know, they say, "What do you mean? How dare you not do what we want?" And so they lose their patience, and it looks like there's a strain. But it's really just the hubris and arrogance of the Israeli leadership who are used to pulling all of our strings and not meeting any kind of no, well, maybe, or later, or and they don't know how to handle that. They're not used to it.
What a shame. Well, if you could give us an update on the most important economic factors going on, too. I know you've been writing that as well, of course. I mean, it's your focus.
Well, there's no recovery. The only evidence of a recovery is the gross domestic product, the real gross domestic product that is deflated with the newer measures or the newer methodologies used to measure the consumer price index. You see, they have changed in two big ways since about 1980. One way is there are many kinds of adjustments made for quality improvements. And so they use these adjustments to reduce the rate of inflation. They say, oh, that's not really a higher price, that's an increase in quality. Now, some of that is correct, but a good deal of it is simply the product of mathematical models trying to estimate it. It's nebulous. And it may or may not be there, but the effect is, the overall effect that we are confident of is that the inflation rate is reduced by these estimates more than is likely to be the case. And then another thing they have done, now that all started around 1980, 1981, and grew over the decades. Now, beginning with Clinton, they did something else. They added a new development, a new methodology. Instead of measuring inflation with a fixed basket of goods in order to see what the cost of a fixed standard of living was, they used a substitution principle. So if the price of something in the basket of goods that they weight to measure inflation, if one of those goes up in price, they simply substitute something else that didn't go up in price. So if sirloin steak goes up in price, They take it out and stick in round state. So it's no longer a consistent measure of inflation because the items in the basket change as their prices change. And so if you add that, then obviously you're going to have a lower rate of inflation. On the other hand, if you deflate the GDP, according to the methodologies, say, prior to 1981, you see there's been a tremendous drop and really no recovery. And no other indice or evidence shows a recovery. If you look at, for example, real retail sales, they've not come close to recovering. If you look at consumer confidence, it's not come close to recovering. Or housing starts. I mean, they're still way down where they were in 2009, 2010. So there's just no sign of recovery. And yet one was declared by the National Bureau of Economic Research. They declared it in 2010 and said that it had occurred in 2009. Actually, in my opinion, based on the statistical work of John Williams, we're still in the recession. It's now four or more years old. And this is a serious situation for a country to be in. If you look at average weekly earnings and use, say, 1967 dollars deflated by the CPIW. The wages today are below where they were in 1964, the real wages. They're far below where they were in 1973. So, and of course, they're far below where they were in the Reagan years. So with these kinds of measures and this kind of evidence, we have to ask why none of this comes out in the financial press. Why is it not in the financial news? Why isn't Congress holding hearings? Why instead we hear all this stuff? Oh, recovery, or oh, we have job increases in jobs. It's just all BS. People are living in the matrix.
Yeah. Well, Doctor, I don't know if you connect the dots in the same way I do, but of course, there is the potential for a perfect storm brewing, another war, the economic crisis, and a number of very heavy-handed measures building up to sort of contain the people if that crisis reaches, I guess, a tipping point. We covered today congressional hearings on Homeland Security's monitoring basically dissidents and bloggers and so forth, and the FBI this week branding sovereigns and just about any kind of ordinary American with an opinion as a potential terrorist. Where does the rubber meet the road? How bad can things get, and what are we likely to see if things reach this tipping point?
Well, they obviously have a police state there, and they'll use it if they need to or have a chance or think they need to. There's nothing to stop it. The courts have given up. Congress have endorsed it. You know, when they codified the amendment, you know, that amendment to the National Defense Authorization Act, what that did, that codified all the violations of the Constitution that Bush had gotten away with. Bush didn't have law behind him. The law was against him. But they established through use those powers. And now they're codified in the law so that Obama is not at risk if he uses them. Nobody can say, as they did of Bush, that he's behaving illegally and should be arrested. And now he can use them with the full force of the law. They remain unconstitutional. And whether or not someone can get standing to bring the case and whether or not the Supreme Court would hear it and overturn this codification, I don't know. We can hope something like that happens. But if not, what we have is no longer accountable to law. And our civil liberties protected by the Constitution and its amendments are gone. they can be removed just at the discretion of someone in the executive branch. It doesn't even have to be the president.
I mean, those of us paying attention, I think, are almost universally outraged, or should be. But those who serve the system, is there any point where they get out of the bureaucratic mode and start to remember that they're doing this to actual people?
I don't think so. Look, anyone who's got power loves to use it. Just think about something very simple. Suppose a man and woman are living together, they're not married. Suppose one or the other of them has some medical issue, and their partner can't get access to the data because they're not married. Mm-hmm. And it makes no sense, but a nurse or a doctor would use this power because, oh, we've got this power to deny you, and they routinely do, from everything that I hear. So I think people are enamored of power. If they have it, they want to use it. And so I don't think we will have any Gestapo running around acting like Jesus Christ. I think they'll act like Gestapo.
So unfortunate. Anything else you'd like to add as we close here?
Well, I think we've talked about a lot. We can probably close.
Yes, sir.
We have to keep our eyes open because things can happen very quickly, and we can all be deceived. And surely a false flag attack, if Washington can stand up and say, oh, the Iranians attacked us, they sunk a ship, or they attacked a ship, then the people are going to rush into the war. They'll forget all about how they were deceived in Vietnam and Iraq and everywhere else. They'll just say, oh, we've got to defend our country, and that'll be it. That's how it works. It always works.
We're in a lot of trouble. Of course, you're right. We have to remain vigilant. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Roberts. Your website, again, is paulcraigroberts.org, correct?
Correct.
And that's where you can find all your most recent articles, as well as on InfoWars. That's it for tonight's InfoWars Nightly News. We'll be back again tomorrow, and keep watching. Thank you.